knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
Now that we've studied the one-dimensional wave equation, let's take a look at what can happen when we move to higher dimensions. Whereas the 1D wave equation can be thought of as modeling vibrations of a string, the 2D wave equation can be used to model vibrations of a membrane, like a drum. If we write down the 2D wave equation, we can use separation of variables, and this time we can separate into a spatial component, which we'll call capital R of XY, and a temporal component, capital T of T. You might recognize our spatial equation is actually the Helmholtz equation, which we briefly mentioned in the tutorial on Laplace's equation. When we solve each of these with the conditions of the displacement u being 0 on the boundary of a rectangle of width l and height h, we get the following product. Notice that we are now performing a double summation over two sets of indices, one for the vibrational modes in the x direction and one for the y direction. This greater diversity of mode shapes leads to some interesting patterns, and these vibrational modes can be considered the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian operator. A membrane that is displaced will vibrate in all of these mode shapes to varying degrees in a similar fashion to the 1D waves on a string we saw previously. Let's now take a quick look at a variation of the 2D wave equation. This equation doesn't have a particular name, but it does have some very interesting properties. If we take our two-dimensional membrane and give it some mass and elasticity, such as a solid thin plate made of a strong material, the vibrations in this plate will be modeled by this equation, which comes from something called Kirchhoff-Love plate theory. This is a fourth-order PDE, and we can verify that the left side is actually the Laplacian of the Laplacian of U. This Laplacian squared operator is often referred to as the biharmonic operator. Just like the 2D wave equation, the free vibrations of a membrane occur with different modes and nodal lines. The eigenfunctions of the biharmonic operator yield some more interesting patterns and are best visualized by their nodal lines, which are called Chladni patterns. If you sprinkle some fine sand onto a plate attached to a vibration generator and steadily tweak the vibrational frequency, you will see the sand grains spontaneously arrange themselves into these striking patterns along the nodal lines at certain resonant frequencies, as the sand grains experience forces pushing them away from regions where the vibrations are stronger to where the plate is not moving. Now let's move up into three dimensions. In Cartesian coordinates, the analysis is practically identical to the 2D wave equation, just now with a z component and a triple summation over all the vibrational modes. But we can also study waves in spherical coordinates, and this brings some interesting applications in itself. The formula for the Laplacian in spherical coordinates is quite intimidating, but it can be tackled using separation of variables just like before. If we make the choice to keep the two angular components, we end up with three Sturm-Liouville problems: a radial component, an angular component, and a temporal component. The temporal component is easy to solve, and we will clearly get trigonometric functions. The radial component is a little trickier, and it can only be solved with a special function called the spherical Bessel function. The angular component is in itself a PDE. We're skipping over quite a lot of the algebra here, but the solution turns out to be something called the spherical harmonics, denoted YLM of theta phi, which themselves are defined in terms of another special function called the associated Legendre polynomials. What is probably more interesting than all the equations is what these spherical harmonics look like. As the name implies, spherical harmonics are the spherical version of the wave harmonics we saw in the simpler 1D and 2D cases, and with a little modification for visualization purposes, using distance for magnitude and color for phase, they look like this. For those who know a little chemistry, these shapes should look very familiar. They are the shapes of the atomic orbitals, and this is not a coincidence. The solution to the Schrödinger equation that describes the wave function of the electron in the quantum mechanical model of the atom involves finding the angular components of the wave equation in spherical coordinates. The indices L and M, as well as the index N, which comes from the radial component in the context of quantum mechanics, are called quantum numbers, and they determine the different modes of vibration that the electron can be in. Finally, let's wrap up our discussion of the wave equation with a look at dispersion. Recall that for a 1D wave on a string, the angular velocity omega and the wave number k obey the relationship c equals omega over k, where c is the wave speed. In the wave equation, all the waves propagate at the same speed, but we know from daily experience, such as by watching water waves in the ocean approaching a beach, that waves don't always behave like this. Just because something looks like a wave, it doesn't mean that it can be modeled by the same wave equation as uxx equals 1 over c squared utt. Many systems exhibit what is known as dispersion, wherein waves of different wavelengths will propagate at different velocities, and these are usually modeled using more advanced PDEs, such as the third-order wave-like PDE called the KdV equation. For these types of systems, the individual wave crests will propagate at some phase velocity, but if different wavelengths are present in the initial conditions, then the solution will appear to disperse collectively at some different group velocity. The phase velocity is equal to the temporal frequency omega divided by the wave number k, or the magnitude of the k vector in higher dimensions, while the group velocity is equal to the derivative of omega with respect to k, given some dispersion relation expressing omega as a function of k. Dispersion tends to occur when we have a system where the wave speed depends on the wavelength, such as beams of white light refracting in a glass prism, with each wavelength having a slightly different refractive index, and therefore traveling with a slightly different phase velocity, splitting the light into the colors of the rainbow. When dispersion results in crests propagating at their own individual phase velocities for enough time that they become isolated from the other crests in the group, we call these self-stabilized crests solitons. And these can only be found as solutions to non-linear wave-like PDEs, where the superposition principle does not apply. That concludes our investigation of the wave equation and wave-like systems. There's just one more major PDE to look at, but before we move on, let's check comprehension.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.